All right, guys, we're live on YouTube and now we're live on Instagram too. All right, guys, so we're live on YouTube. I'm just waiting to get out for Instagram. I got a fun one for you guys today. We're going to talk about 10 essential moves that you need in martial arts. Hold on a second. So, yeah, we're going to talk about 10 essential moves that you absolutely need in martial arts. Now, some of these are going to be like real basic, and some of them are going to be a little bit foreign to some of you guys, but we're going to stick with offensive moves, right? So, hey, we're live on Instagram too, so again, we're going to do 10 moves that you absolutely need to master in martial arts if you want to get good, specifically at striking, and we're going to stick with some offensive moves. So again, 10 moves in martial arts that you're going to need to kind of be proficient and a good practitioner. I'm just going to review through some of them quickly, and then we're going to go through some setups. And if you guys want to see some additional moves, we'll definitely go through them, but these are 10 that you absolutely need if you want to have a solid martial arts foundation, right? So, move number one, we beat this one to death, is a good jab, right? Just look at the old videos, the old streaming videos. We've just done lesson upon lesson on the jab, right? So that's move number one. Move number two is the straight lead. Right, so the longer, stronger version of the jab. So those of us just joining us, we're going to be doing 10 essential moves that you need in martial arts and some setups. So move number one, jab. Move number two, vertical fist jab, which is the straight lead. That's the longer, stronger version of the jab. So that's move number two. Move number three is you need to be able to throw your hooks, right? So you need to be able to throw a curve line shot, hook, that's three. Uppercut is four. Number five is the cross, right, the backhand. Number six is the backhand. Let's go through our hands. Jab, straight lead, that's two. Hook, uppercut, that's three, four. Five is the cross. Now, last tool in Jeet-Kune-Do is the back fist, that snapping shot. So imagine somebody's face like a cup. If we do all these punches, you'll notice that we hit every angle. The jab, the straight lead, and the cross hit right in the middle of the face. The hooks hit this side of the face, as does the back fist, hits that side of the face, and our uppercuts hit on the knee. So with those simple six punches, we're able to hit any area on the head, right? So now if we move to the legs, lead leg roundhouse kick, rear leg roundhouse kick, right? So that's 7-8, right? Now, nine, front leg or rear leg front kick. And we're gonna cluster the pendulum front kick. So our front kicks are number nine. And our last side kick, right? Whether it's to the knee, bang, or to the belly, right? Not a traditional kick that you would see in certain styles, but Jeet-Kune-Do throws them. So that's your 10 moves. Jab, straight lead, hook, uppercut, back fist, rear leg front kick, rear leg hook kick, you have your side kick, right? I forgot a few. So jab is number one, straight lead is number two, hooks, number three, uppercuts, number four, back fist is number five, the rear straight or the cross is number six, seven, lead hook kick, eight, rear leg hook kick. Nine, we'll put two of them together, is our front kicks with either leg, and then side kicks with the lead leg. It's just 10 moves that you absolutely unequivocally need to know, right? So let's kind of just get into a few of the setups, right, for the straight lead itself. Because the straight lead is the bread and butter punch, even though we beat the jab to death in some of the older videos. So let's get into the mechanics of the straight lead. What makes it different, and a couple of like real easy setups. So we're in a fighting position, front toe to the back heel, chin down, shoulders high. Now the straight lead is a vertical fist jab where the shoulders turn more than on a traditional jab. So on a traditional jab, your hip and your shoulder turn a little bit, fist is horizontal. On a straight lead, chin still tucked, shoulders turn a little bit more, and you're snapping, right? So you're just bang. I'm gonna try to just demo that real slow. You're driving off the back foot, hand is coming pin straight, rotating the shoulders and coming right back to center. So one of the principles that Bruce Lee kind of borrowed from fencing was moving your hand. If I had a foil, right, I'd move the foil or the hand first. Now, believe it or not, this actually generates more power than stepping, landing, and punching. I'll explain the physics of it in a second, right? Imagine yourself in an arc, right? If I'm pushing towards you, I've taken a small arc. If I land my front foot and then punch, if I land my lead foot and then punch, that's mechanically incorrect from a force perspective because a lot of your mass has hit the floor and you are not fighting the floor. Only crazy people fight the floor. So if you step and then punch, again, your mass will be in the floor. If you move your hand first slightly, when I say slightly, I mean ever so slightly before your feet move, you will be less telegraphic. It will be harder for the person to see you, one. And number two, you'll have more force because you'll be landing that punch not as your foot lands, but right before your foot lands, and therefore the mass of your body weight will accelerate into the target and you will do more damage. So I'm gonna break that down real slow, right? Let's take two options. If I step, land, punch, a lot of my mass is in the floor. But if I hit you while I'm ever so slightly in the air, you'll notice that there's a lot more power, a lot more damage is done. So let's kind of like hear it on the pad. Step, fire. Step, fire. Versus pushing or moving the hand first, then moving the feet. You hear the second one has a lot more force, a lot more stopping power. That's one of the quote unquote secrets to the straight lead. It's to not move your feet and then your hand. It's your lead hand, the second it leaves your ribs, like literally one half of an inch, feet start moving, feet start moving, feet start moving. And when people see Jeet Kune Do practitioners, they go, wow, that's not very telegraphic. It's hard to see it. Like, what's easier to see? Or, I'm trying to go like at the same speed and the same rhythm and cadence. Like, see, my lead foot is going before my hand or right with my hand, right? Versus, lead hand moves first, bang, driving. And on this hand, my elbow is leaving my ribs ever so slightly before my front foot steps. So now again, I'm less telegraphic and I end up with more power because imagine my arm is the floor, I'm coming through the air, my hand moves first, and I land the punch right before my feet hit the ground. So now force equals mass times acceleration. The mass of my body weight is accelerating through the air, hitting the target right before it hits the ground, and this is the law of being a projectile object. And if there was a projectile object, imagine like a missile. Missile's coming through and it hits like a wall. Bang. Well, one of the reasons why it's going to do damage to the wall is because it's accelerating quickly, but it hasn't hit the ground and knows that. If that missile hit the ground and then rolled into the wall, it wouldn't do the same damage as that missile's coming through the air and hits the wall as it's in the air. You want to make yourself that type of projectile object when you're advancing and hitting from a force perspective, right? So let's go through some setups on the straight lead, right? First one, real simple. Guy stepping towards me, I take one step back. Second time I go half step back, fire. So imagine the guy's coming after me. I step back once, then I take a half step back and I fire that straight lead. So nice and slow. Step back once, half step, fire that straight lead a little faster. Bang. So it's like a little modified snap away to kind of lure the guy in, right? Similar motion, right, but slightly different because now we're going to move our head. Guy's swinging a wide shot underneath or straight down the middle at my head. My head moves, my back foot moves, and then I fire the straight lead. So my head moves, my back foot moves, and I fire the straight lead. This is called snap away, a little faster. Snap fire, right? Now, again, when you fire a straight lead, you want to rotate those shoulders. And you want to basically fortify this shoulder with the back shoulder. You want them in line for that split second. So it's bang, it's in line, and then it hits. So it's in line, and then you return. It's in line, and then you return. Question?
What's that McGregor's favorite KO?
What happened?
That one, my second KO.
You just got it.
What's that McGregor's favorite KO?
Was that McGregor's doing similar things to this. Like, a lot of times you see McGregor doing this. He'll step back, fire the left hand, because he's very left-hand centric, but he's throwing like an upward jab, which is sort of similar, but not exactly the same. That's a good question. McGregor's using a lot of like bladed in and out footwork, because again, he trains at Straight Blast Gym. Straight Blast is just this motion in Wing Chun. And it's a JKD name, obviously. Straight Blast, JKDS. But he's doing a lot of motions that are in and out like Jeet Kune Do. It's a very good question. So more setups for the straight lead, right? A lot of times, guy fires a shot, I slip, and then I straight lead. So imagine the guy's firing his right hand, I slip first, drive off my foot, keep my head on the left. It's a little bit more of an advanced setup. So that punch whizzes by my ear, I didn't have time to intercept it, hit it as the person's coming in. I'm like, whoa, I got to go bang, and I'm firing. Now keep in mind, when someone throws a straight right hand, and they slip, we're in range. So I do just a baby push off the back leg, turn the shoulders, and I'm firing. So slip by. Slip pop. So again, just, I hope you're visual enough for this, right? And I think most of you definitely are, because most of us learn from a visual standpoint, not auditory. Imagine someone's punching. I slip, so the punch is over this shoulder, driving and firing the straight lead. Now, little safety tip on this setup for the straight lead is I would keep my head on the left as I'm stepping into fire. So I keep my head on the left. What's up?
You have a question. So is there also a step forward or back when recovering from the straight lead?
Oh yeah, so that's a good question. I'll answer it more holistically. Every move has an initiation, an execution, and then a recovery, right? So imagine real simple recovery. I initiate, I hit the tool. Now watch, when I return, as my arm is pulling back, I work that push shuffle back that we showcased in some of the previous videos, both on YouTube and Instagram. So if you ever hear of a fighter saying, get in and out, you hear like good coaches say, get in and out with your footwork, right? Get in and out with your striking. That's exactly one example. I push in on that straight lead, bang, and then I'm simply pushing out of range. Option two, I push and then I sidestep, I clear the line. So again, option two, straight lead, sidestep, I clear the line. We did this one to death the other day, straight lead curve step. And again, I clear the line. The one that you were asking about is a straight lead into a retracting motion, which is, in this case, a push shuffle, right? And you have to master the jab and the straight lead if you want to get good at Jeet Kune Do both. You gotta be really good at both, because the jab flicks it, does a lot of like peppering damage and sets up the backhand. The straight lead is naturally a longer, stronger tool, but it's a little bit more committed. So to get good at Jeet Kune Do, you have to master that horizontal fist jab with a slight shoulder turn and slight hip turn, and the straight lead with more of a shoulder turn, more of a hip turn. And the cool thing is, these tools are married. Watch. Jab. See the distance? Now when I throw the straight lead, it's deeper and longer on the second shot. So on the jab, I do a little baby step, turn the shoulders a little bit. On the straight lead, it's a slightly deeper step with more of a turn. So there's a manipulation of distance when you get good at both, right? One more setup for the straight lead itself, right? Guy's firing at you, and simple, right? McGregor-esque. Guy's firing at me, I push back and fire. I open the distance, and I return. I open the distance and return. And it's so important that you're able to maintain this distance on your terms and your will, as opposed to letting the opponent dictate distance and terms, right? Guy fires a shot, I make it miss just enough and I fire back. Comfortable, right? Sometimes I don't even move my feet, right? Sometimes I'm here, I rock back, my feet don't even move, and I fire. Sometimes I rock back, one foot moves, and I fire. Sometimes the shot's real deep, both feet move, and then I return fire. So that simple manipulation of distance is awesome when it comes to straight lead. One more, I'm getting excited about the straight lead. A lot of times, guys come pin straight on the straight lead. Sometimes you curve step with it, bam. So I fire the straight lead as I'm moving to the right. So I don't have to go full quarter turn like this. It's probably not gonna work. It's a simple side step, right? So that shot's coming straight at my face, bang, I'm sidestepping, shoulders up, vertical fist, and I'm firing and blasting that straight shot at the counter. The way this looks is I'm here, and I'm shifting as I'm firing. So I'm here, so I'm firing, right? So instead of going pin straight, I'm going this way. And I get the length of the straight lead, right? Instead of shortening up with the jab, I sidestep as I'm curving. So again, if I notice that guy's chin is a little high and shoulder's not covering his chin on the jab, he throws his jab, I just clip it right over the top. I throw my longer, stronger counter versus the jab, right? Now, Jeet Kune Do is very, very, very lead hand and lead leg centric for good reasons that I can get into a thorough discussion later if you guys want. But you also have to be able to throw the backhand, right? So we're starting with the straight shots. We're gonna end our last straight shot with our punches with our left hand now, which is our cross. Now, what's cool about Jeet Kune Do is you learn it both stationary and in motion. So let's go through it stationary first. Front toe of that back heel. Head is over my pelvis, chin down, shoulders high. I turn the back foot and I wrench the cross, right? So I turn the back foot, shift my head over my right thigh, fire the cross. My shoulder is up, protecting my chin. My pillar is up on this side with the shoulder. So I'm protecting the round shots and I'm hiding behind my shoulders. Good defense in conjunction with the offense. Now notice, you know somebody's firing the cross improperly when they're doing this. They fire it and their head stays on centerline. Even if my feet don't move out or back, my head should shift on the cross right over my lead thigh. What this does is it simultaneously slips you offline of straight shots and it loads the weights harder on that right leg. So let me repeat. It slips your head offline for the straight shots and it loads the weight harder for your right leg. So let me just get a pair of gloves on actually. I need a demo of you stationary and then we'll do it in motion too. And guys, keep the questions coming during the entire thing. I'm gonna leave 10 minutes at the end specifically for questions as well, but keep them coming during the entire time. Another just quick note, we're gonna be doing these every 7 p.m. to 8 p.m., Monday through Friday, and Saturday at 12. The kids' classes are Tuesday and Thursday at 6 to 6:30. But, you know, as we're doing these, you know, I'm having a lot of fun actually like teaching you guys via live chat and all that stuff. But again, keep the questions coming because if there's something you want to see more of and you ask, I'm definitely going to show up, right? So let's look at it from the back because you'll see my head shift offline. And here, see my head started on center with his target, the head. When I fired, my head came off center. It's a very important detail that a lot of people forget. They fire the cross like this. Their head is on center. The head shifts off center, even if we're completely stationary. Let's do a few more. Fire. 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 Right? Now, I wasn't planning on giving you guys like a little masterclass on the cross, but I'll get as many details as we can, right? I showed you the stationary one. My head shifts and I fired the cross off center line, right? Now, we can do a full push shuffle out and make this, instead of a cross, it's a rear straight. So my hands are doing the same thing, but my feet are shifting out. So we're here, feet shift out, feet shift out, feet shift out. So I'm out on a 45. So I started here, I shift out on a 45. Both feet move, I shift out on a 45. Again, we can call that a rear straight in Jeet Kune Do. Now, what I wouldn't suggest is just stepping in with the cross with no setup. So, you probably don't want to do this, right? One second. You probably don't want to do this, just step in and fire the cross, no setup. You either want to bang, throw it nice and sharp, bang, nice and sharp as you're stepping out. Let me answer the question, I'll get back to the cross.
So, Ramon is asking, he wants you to show the ending of your foot placement after the rear straight or the cross.
Oh yeah, that's a good question. So, when I throw a rear straight, my foot placement is gonna be in a better position than when I fire the cross, right? When I fire a pure cross, my feet are right where they are, my back foot turns, shift, and then I'm gonna exit with my next motion. So I'm gonna fire, quarter turn and exit, which I'll show you right now. You fire the cross, move the head one more inch, move your lead foot one more inch, and turn off, right? It's called quarter turn. So it goes cross and quarter, right? You're gonna fire the cross, slip and quarter. Slip and quarter, right? Now on the rear straight, your feet are already moving towards the right. So you're here, and then you're angling up after anyway, but your feet are starting to move. So the difference is on the cross, my feet are right where they are, and then I quarter turn. on the rear string, my feet are going to start moving this way on the motion. And then I slip and quarter after, right? So cross, stationary, slipping and quartering when you're done. Rear straight, slipping and quartering when you're done. On the rear straight, your feet are moving. Now, this is where it gets cool, right? You can throw the backhand. So we haven't done the backhand stuff, but you can throw the backhand as you're stepping back. So now the guy's rushing me. I don't have time to step back, land, fire the cross. I don't have time for this. Step, cross. So as he steps in, bop, I just fire the cross as the guy's stepping in. So only my back foot moves. I fire the cross. I can finish up with a hook or even just a jab if I want to stay long range. So step back on the cross, fire the jab. Step back on the cross, fire the jab. So we're nice and close now. And I'm stepping back, firing the left hand. Back foot turn. Bang. So see what Tevin did a good job last night going through the four ways you generate force. You have linear motion, downwards motion, upwards motion, and centripetal force. Force around an axis, right? Whenever you go backwards and you strike, and write this down in your notes, remember. Anytime you go backwards in your motions, if you want to generate real force and power, you have to sit on the shot. You have to drop your weight. If you throw this upright, it won't work. Drop the weight, fire low. So you drop the weight on the cross as you're stepping back, and you notice a lot more force on it. So your feet drop, fire. So now a lot of people go, well, you can't do that, well, you're moving backwards, but you don't know what you're talking about. You don't know what you're looking at, you don't know what you're talking about, because you just don't understand motion as it relates to combat yet. And when I look at it, I want to know all the freedom that I have with my tools. I don't want anyone out there, anything, including my own limitations, to stop me from being able to move in different directions with the same tool, right? So think of it, the cross can go stationary, out, backwards, right? Or sidestep and then fire in the left hand. Some guys are like, they pivot on the cross too, which could work. It's super fancy, right? We can get into that a whole other day where, like, you turn and fire the cross. That's a whole section. I can teach a whole hour on just that, right? So now you have the cross. The hooks and the uppercuts next. When you throw your hook, right? Let's start with the arms. Wrist, elbow, shoulder alignment. Chin is protected by the shoulder on this side, protected by the glove and the shoulder on this side, right? Feet, turn. Now remember, I can teach you an entire class on just the hook. I can teach you multiple classes on just the hook. Multiple classes on just the uppercut, just the cross, just the straight leg, just the jab. But today's more of a synopsis for you to see like all the options that you have and like the 10 things you absolutely need to be able to do if you want to be a good martial artist, right? So let's review. 10 moves. Jab, 1. Straight lead, 2. Cross, 3. Hooks, 4. Uppercuts, 5. Back fist, 6. And then we're going to get into the legs, right? You have lead leg roundhouse kick, bang. Rear leg roundhouse kick, front kicks, right? And of course, bang, that side kick, right? So you have every major tool. We're just listing them out today and giving you a few examples, right? So we did the jab, we did the straight leg, we did the cross. Let's do a few hooks and uppercuts now. If you notice, when I throw a stationary hook, my feet will turn in the direction that the force needs to go. My feet will turn in the direction that the force needs to go. Now, big no-nos. No, not big wide shots, tight. Right, like if I'm this close to somebody, if we're literally here, gotta be able to hit it. If we're this close, gotta be able to hit it. If we're right here, just taking his head off, look at the distance. This is not far. Just the hook and the uppercut, when it's thrown tight, is a medium to short range shot, right? Now, let's move to the uppercut real quick, and I'll show you the back fist too. The uppercuts come up the middle. So when you fire uppercuts, you can turn your palms towards you, And just, let's do the lead up. You're gonna do a baby calf raise, and just come right back down. Not this, small. Calves come up, hip turns towards the target, and right back. Right, if I wanna go two, I shift. Shift. It is a slight upwards motion, because remember, you have four ways you generate force. Linear motion, downwards motion, on an uppercut, we're gonna go upwards motion, and a little bit of torque, a little bit of centripetal force. So it's up, little twist, come right back. Little twist, come right back. Little twist, come right back. And if you're throwing multiple, you shift to the opposite leg. Again, to keep your head off center and to work that weight transfer when you're throwing those uppercuts, right? Last one, remember that face, that cup. Straight, around, under. Now we're gonna go around the other side. The back fist. So it's not a chambered back fist like this, no. It's my hand is coming in this trajectory. There, so my knuckles, you can get close to the camera. When you fire this, this is meant to be like a bare knuckle shot. Your wrist turns towards the bad guy. So if I'm hitting this side of his face, bang. Now again, some guys carry their lead, or their rear hand rather, right down the middle. That shot is there. And if you only know how to fire a rear hook, this is a short shot. The back fist is much longer. So if the person's left side of their face, let's say, or excuse me, I'm a righty, right? So if the right side of their face is open, and all I know how to do is to throw a left hook, they're far away, that back fist will score on that same exact line. So fighting is about lines of attack and identifying which lines of attack are open given the way this person is standing, the way they're moving, and where their defects in their defenses are, right? So what did we say in the beginning? My tools need to give me freedom and versatility. Think of that cup, right? This person's face, like a cup, like a U. Straight. Three answers for that. Under. Two answers for that. Hook, and on this side, the back fist. So there's multiple ways to hit that same exact line of attack, so the same exact line that's open, based on the way they're standing, based on the way they're moving, and the opportunities that they present to you. So what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna pass over to Sifu Temi. He's gonna go over some rear leg hooking stuff and some setups for the rear leg hooking, right? Again, guys, keep the questions coming. The last 10 minutes will be exclusively for questions. And just a quick announcement, if you guys want to see all the classes, and let's say you missed one, you want to like go back to a certain section, they're all on YouTube. It just says name of the class, live streaming class. So they've all been posted right after the class. On Instagram, it stays on the stories for 24 more hours, but then disappears. So enjoy the Sifu Temi and have a good time.
All right, guys. So we're going to go over the rear leg hook again. Also, the lead hook kick as well, maybe here and there with the front kicks as well. So, let's start off by getting into our stance. I'm standing side, which you guys can see. I'm going to take my rear foot, right? I'm not going to move it first. What I'm going to move first is my hip. I'm going to rotate my hip. Once my hip starts moving, my leg is going to come pinned straight, right? Imagine there being a wall right next to your leg, and you open up like a traditional karate style roundhouse kick. You go out and around, right? One, it takes too long, it's too telegraphic. My opponent's gonna see that I'm out of the way. I wanna be fast, so as I turn, knee comes up in a straight line. What's gonna determine me from throwing a really front kick with a really hook kick is the rotation on the balls of my front foot. So what's gonna happen is I'm gonna pivot on the balls of my front foot, not my heel, because the faster I rotate, the more power I generate. Right, so from here, as I throw that rear leg hook kick. Now you guys notice also my hand placement, right? Rear hand is up, lead hand is slightly down, a little lowered. When I throw that rear leg hook kick to maintain myself properly covered and balance, the switch rolls here, right? Hand comes down to my rear knee, front hand comes up to my face to protect myself from any incoming attack, because when I throw this rear leg hook kick, I'm in a medium to close range, so I need to keep my cover up. So I'm down here, and I'm right back. And I am right back. Now, another thing, when you land this rear leg hook kick, you don't want to land with the side of your foot, You want to land with your shin, strongest bone in your leg. If I rotate and I land my side of my ankle on a person's kneecap or their shin, right, or on their hip, I'm going to shatter my ankle. But if I slam my shin against their own shin, their kneecap, their hip, their thigh, right, the body, I'll be dealing more damage and I won't be injuring myself in the process. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to borrow this right here. Now you guys can see the difference in placement. So I'm here, right, if I just turn and go, as I go here. Right? It's a lot harder. Clearly, you guys can see what happens after a few preliminary kicks. Right? Bring this back here. So again, the difference in power, if I do not rotate and I just step like a traditional roundhouse kick, yeah, it has some power, but it's slower. One, two. Opposed to going here. It's quicker, and I still generate, in my personal opinion, more power than stepping, opening the foot, kind of roundhouse kick, right? So now some setups with the rear leg hook kick. No one's ever gonna allow you to just go and use that rear leg hook on them. So you're gonna be able to hide it, right? So what you can do is you can go with that jab, right? You can fake the jab, high to why divert their attention away from your real goal, which is to land that really hook kick on the knee, the thigh, the hip, or the body, depending on where you're trying to land that really hook kick, right? So I go here. I step off to a 45, land that really hook kick again. Stretch you guys from this angle too. Step off. One. Rear leg hook kick. Again. So as I'm stepping off, what happens is I've already opened up my hip and then my head is also coming with me offline. So that way I don't run into anyone's shots. I go one. And then I just turn, land down, rear leg hook kick. So I demonstrated a lot of here. I go here. Right, and as you can see, it has a lot of power behind it. What you guys can also do is you go 1-2 on the jab cross. 1-2, throw that rear leg hook in. Right, I'll demonstrate it here. I'll go, right? When I throw that rear leg hook in. Now, let's go over that pendulum hook in. Because then we're going to tie it in together with the rear leg hook kick. So when you throw your pendulum hook kick, you slide your back foot up. You don't want to step, step, kick, right? It's too slow. I slide that back foot up. My back foot opens up. So this allows my knee hip to come around again, landing on your shin. You don't want to land on the side of your foot. I go one, boom. And I come right back up. And I'm right back.
So, I'm just hopping forward. So there's something that he's doing that's very important. If you notice, his knee on the hook kick is above his heel and his ankle. This is a big no-no. You don't do this when you throw round kicks. You never turn your heel up. Either you're directly parallel, or more common, if it goes up to the body, the knee is above the heel, right? So think of it like, if you're going up, it can come up this way, or it can come directly across. Your heel never flies higher than your lead knee, like you never flip your leg up. Just take a look at his lead knee when he's throwing that hook kick.
This way, so when you guys can see, I'm here.
Bam, exactly. And the way he's placing that, his shin is going to slam into the target as opposed to any soft stuff like the side of your thigh or the side of your calf. Basically, that strong shin bone, the part of the shin bone right here is going to lace into the target.
Right. So let's demonstrate a few hard angel hookings. I'm here, I slide in, and I'm right back. And as you guys can see, I'm landing with my shin. If I try to gain that kind of power and land with my ankle, I would no longer be able to stand and further demonstrate the pendulum hook kick or any other tool because I had already blown down my ankle. So that's no good. So again, you want to land your kicks with the rear leg hook kick and the pendulum hook kick with your shin. That's where you deal the most amount of damage. So again, here, and I'm right back. And I am right back. So now let's tie in that pendulum hook kick, right, with some setup to it. So now you're a little closer, right? Now you can't slide in, do that damage. What you can do is you can do something known as a quick switch. You open up, and you, right, you go. Now, of course, I'm showing to you guys a little bit slower, so that way you guys can see. I go one, two, right, I come over here. But how you throw this tool is like this. You go here, and you're right back. So again, I'm able to throw this lead hook kick, not only from the long range, but also a little bit closer, right? Without limiting my tool. Now, to also do a stationary hook kick where I'm here, I just lift my knee, turn this back leg up. A lot of damage without having to do what? Step kick, right? Have a little comment over here. There you go. That's right. So now let's tie it together, the pendulum hook kick with the rear leg hook kick. So now let's say your intentions are not to land the first tool, but to really go after the guy on the second tool. So what ends up happening is you go a little on this side, you fake that pendulum hook kick, or maybe you use it to get it to see a certain reaction on your opponent. The person falls for it, he gets out of the way. You land forward and you go with that rear leg hook kick. I'm here, you go one, you show it to him. You see, you're still generating power, right? Maybe, right? With the pendulum hook kick, you go one, two, the person opens up the distance by a greater amount. So you slide in, and you throw that pendulum hook in. Now the reason why I'm getting power off of this is look at the way it land on that one, two, jab, cross. My central line is exposed, my hips are spread up. So when I slide in, I have more rotational force behind that pendulum hook in, which is gonna allow me to generate more force. So I'm here, one, two, and I'm right back. Right, and again, every single time I'm hitting power. Same thing goes for the pendulum hooking to a rear leg hook. I'm going one, I step off to a 45, land heel to ball to reset myself. Right angle. Oops. Getting a little too carried away. But again, the motion is here. And I am right back into my stance, ready to fire. So again, a couple of setups with the rear leg hook kick, pendulum hook kick, right? And also combining the kicks together, right? One, two. One, two. Lead hook kick, right? Step off line, throw that rear leg hook kick, right? You can always go one, two, three. Now I'm a jab cross hook. You want to land that really hooking? Look at the body weight distribution here. One, two. All my weight is loaded up on this rear foot. So when I turn it in, power. I'm one, two, three. I load it, and then I'm unloading. Same thing goes for here. One, two. Everything is loaded up, and I have more power on my advancement to finish the guy off. So I hope you guys enjoy that little quick little rear leg hook kick,
demonstration and the pendulum hooking demonstration. With a few setups, I'll pass it back over to Senior James. Thank you guys so much.
All right, guys, so as promised, 10 tools, right? 10 types of attacks in martial arts. So we have a few more. We have our front kicks and a few different versions of our front kicks, and of course our side kick as well, right? So let's review jab, straight lead, hook, uppercut, cross, back thrust. Those are the punches that we went over today. We just did lead leg hook kick, which is our lead leg roundhouse kick, rear leg hook kick, which is our rear leg roundhouse kick. Now we're gonna go over our front kicks and our side kicks, right? So front kick is really cool because whether you go with the rear leg or the lead leg, and I'm gonna go with the lead leg today because a lot of people show the rear leg, we're gonna go up to the groin and of course into the body. So classic Jeet Kune Do move that you probably won't see in many other martial arts is that pendulum front kick, right to the groin. So you're here, you bring the back foot in a few inches, slide it up, and that lead, basically my Adidas sign, would go into the person's midsection or the groin in this case. If you're fighting with someone who happens to stand very square, like their feet are wide enough that their groin is an open opportunity, this pendulum front kick is a great action. And a lot of times when people come into the academy and they see this on the focus, and it's like one guy will be holding like this, and the other guy will be coming up the middle with the front kick. What is that? What's the target? It's the groin, right? Now you can also go in with the front kick. Like I could slide up, pop, and just put the bottom of my foot, bang, into the midsection, right, as well. Good target areas, the bladder itself, of course the groin that we mentioned, anything on the center line, right, the solar plexus thing, that, but probably the best one, besides the groin itself, is the liver, right? Gonna give you a quick anatomy lesson, right? Squeeze your abs and just touch your abs. Bring your fingers all the way to your ribs. Now on the right side, meet halfway in between. Underneath that last rib, so your liver's about this big. But the way to get to it is underneath that last rib, if you just take your fingers and press, it gets really uncomfortable because your liver is exposed. That's why body shots to the liver put people down. Now a lot of times, punches put people down, but kicks can also put people down to the liver. So like, a lot of times guys square, my left straight kick, bang, will just place into the liver properly. And I'm gonna try to do this so you can see in the cameras, my toes curl. So I hit this with my shoe on, of course, but my toes curl so that I can land with the ball of my foot. The ball of your foot is just when you go on your tippy toes, that area, as opposed to your entire foot, because it's basic physics, right? Same reason a spear punctures you. Same kind of force, smaller area, the pain is sharper, and it ends up penetrating further deeper. Think of it, if I took a spear and I just went like this, right? Like I had the spear in my hand, I just poked you with it, it would obviously stab you because the point of the spear is sharp, it's very small. If, take the same idea, it's like if I just lift my leg and push you with the entire bottom of my foot, the energy disperses, right? Just basic physics. But if I hit you with the ball of my foot, less surface area, same amount of force, more damage, right? So that rear leg front kick, let's review, or the pendulum front kick, or front kicks in general, can go up the middle, straight in, up the middle on the left leg, straight in on the left leg, and we can go through setups on another day, right? A fun one that Jeet Kune Do made famous, and some of the traditional martial arts throw as well, is a side kick, and there's a lot of ways to do it. You can shuffle your feet in, slide in, turn them in side kick, right, which you do in every class. You can also lift your leg, skip into the side kick towards the knee. So the way that looks is like, we're here, I'm just lifting and firing. I'm lifting and firing. And surface area that you're hitting with, your heel is fortified by your tip fin, which is your shin and your femur. So those bones will line up behind the heel in this case better. Because instead of a front kick where you're hitting with the ball of the foot, it'd be almost impossible to hit with the heel. You lift, turn, and that side kick, bang, is scored, bang, with that lead heel. So you're here, and I'm firing. I lift, and I'm firing. Of course, if I was further, I can shuffle, and fire, right? I could be here, shuffle, and fire as well. So if you're noticing there's a theme in what we're saying, Some people will have a preference for the shorter tools, like the shorter footwork, like the skip. Some people will like a slide. The truth is you don't have a choice. You have to be able to do both. Why? Distance. The lift and skip for closer. The slide is for further. Same type of idea. Let's go back to what Sifu Temi was saying. We're out here. His leg is open now on this side. I'm firing that hook kick. We're here, now instead of out here, we're closer, different forward. So you get some guys go, well, I like the first switch. Yeah, what if the guy's far? I like the hook kick, the pendulum. What if the guy's close? You need to be able to do both, basically. What's up?
So, a question for the sidekick. Does a sidekick, the foot penetrate before the leg comes down on the floor?
The back leg? So the side kick is a funny one, right? So your back foot's gonna hit the floor before you land the actual kick on this one. On a hook kick, it's a great question. Who asked that? Awesome question, right? So on the pendulum hook kick, you're turning this back foot midair, and you're probably scoring this shot as you're technically in the air. On the side kick, you need more stability because there's equally an opposite force coming your way. So you're gonna land your lead foot right as this back foot is landing. So right as this back foot starts landing, lean lift, and I fire. Right, so knee lift, and I fire. Now, another common thing with the side kick is retracting your knee. When you hit it, retract your knee because there's gonna be equally an opposite force coming your way, and if you hit something solid, you'll bounce. One question?
So it lands the same time. That's what it
looks like. Yeah, it's basically landing almost at the same time. It's like the back foot's gonna still land slightly before the kick comes. Right? But your momentum is being carried forward. You basically don't let your weight die. You don't do this. Slide, lift, fire. It's momentum coming forward and then the kick is landing. So your back foot is technically landing and then the shot is scoring, but your momentum is still carrying you forward on the side kick. On the hook kick, you're technically landing in midair, so you're more of a projectile object. That's a great question, by the way. So we went over some of the basic tools that you can do. Like, you know, we didn't get into foul tactics like finger jabs, headbutts, grappling moves, and things of that nature, but these are 10 essential moves that you need to master. Not just be good at, master if you want to take your game to the highest level possible. Right, let's do them again. Jab, straight, that's two. Cross, three, hook, uppercut, four, five, right? So one, two, three, right? Jab, straight, lead, cross, that's three. Hook, four, uppercuts, five. Cross, or we already did the cross, that's five. Back fist is six. For your kicks, basics, lead leg roundhouse kick, rear leg roundhouse kick. Really, the front kicks have a bunch of variations. You cluster them together. You can technically go pendulum front kick, rear leg front kick. So I would make it 11 with the side kick, but I just clustered the front kicks together. So, of course there's elbows. Of course there's knees. Of course there's eye gouges. Of course there's pucks. I just give you real basic ones to say that this is where you would start. And when I say start, I mean your first couple of years. Because a lot of people go, well, I've been training 2-3 years and I'm all this. And that's fine, but you don't have time yet to be able to pull this stuff off to the highest level that you can. Give yourself time. Martial arts done at the highest level takes time because it's dynamic. Would you be able to play basketball at a high level after a couple of years? No. Would you be able to play football after a high level for a couple of years? No. This stuff takes time. Unless you're just some superhuman and you're crazy athletic and you're able to just do exactly what I say without practicing, which is impossible, right? You may be a superhuman athlete, but you just need time doing this, and you can do it, man. Like, I'm telling you, I've seen crazy things happen in this school. I've seen people that weren't athletic, but they just worked hard. They put their bag over their shoulders and put their boxing gloves on, and they worked hard day in, day out. And they started out pacing a lot of the guys and gals that were much more athletic, much more naturally gifted. So I get students all the time, and they ask me the same question with different words, like, how do I get good? I'm going through a hard time. My main answer is trust the process, and most importantly, trust yourself. Because know that you're no different than me in the sense that I wasn't the most talented guy on the training floor. I just worked hard. And if you work hard, you're going to get good too.
So Roland's asking, when it comes to grappling, what's your particular preference? BJJ, wrestling, sambo, or judo?
Good question. So I hold rank in jiu-jitsu, by the way. Like, I'm a purple in jiu-jitsu. I was a purple for like 7 years. I just took the gi off. So I won all the competitions, nagas, the grappler's quest, all this stuff, right? But I also did a lot of wrestling with Sifu Paul initially, and then Sifu Paul brought me into a guy named Vuvar, who I'll probably bring him for a seminar at some point. He's from the Soviet Union. He's a bronze medal at the Olympics, two-time world champion. And in my humble opinion, the way we teach the classes here in New York Martial Arts Academy, they're much more wrestling-centric than you would find in a typical MMA studio here in New York, where it's just like Muay Thai on the feet and Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu on the floor. So you see a lot of like BJJ guys on the floor and Muay Thai guys. But how do I get the guy on the floor? My question always to Jiu-Jitsu guys is like, well, how do I get the guy on the floor? Like, they don't show a lot of takedowns. And a lot of the good Jiu-Jitsu schools, they're on with the gi and the kimono, and their no-gi isn't as good as their gi, so nobody walks around with a kimono, right? So I always liked wrestling because it was no-gi, first of all. It teaches you how to take the guy down, like short choppy stuff. Like in wrestling, you learn stuff like this, like when you're shooting and you're coming up, you can just modify that and simply lower your level, drive, and get those same short choppy steps like in a double leg, right? So just demo that one more time, like lower level, drive, short choppy steps, single legs, high crotches, throws. So I like wrestling, and there's a lot more wrestling in our curriculum than you'll see in most places because it teaches you how to take somebody down. As a striker, it teaches you how to avoid the takedown. Look at Israel Adesanya, people look at his last performance, whatever, but he's a kickboxer, world championship kickboxer. He learned defensive wrestling. So if you want to be a striker, you gotta learn your defensive wrestling first. Your sprawls, your hand fighting, your head control, basics of grappling. So for all my students, come to the grappling classes. Come to the Wednesday night in Astoria, come to the Saturday afternoon with Sifu Paul, and in Little Neck and Vancouver, mixing it into the curriculum anyway. We're doing a lot of wrestling, a lot of grappling in the classes too. So we like wrestling because of the control. Another fun fact, most UFC champions come from wrestling background. Wrestling moves are hard, and it's just a good skill to have for MMA, and I believe it's a good skill to have for self-defense as well. But again, I'm going to show you guys like basic submission defenses, things of that nature, things that are more Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu-esque that are important as well. So some of it is I'm going to take the best stuff from wrestling, the best stuff from Jiu-Jitsu for self-defense, and just show it to you guys. Any other questions? Just keep the questions coming, because we're in question time now. Where's that?
Is it encouraged for students to partake in tournaments or not?
Do we want? Like Sifu Paul just won the expert division of NAGA, which is one of the biggest grappling tournaments in the nation. So expert, he won the belt, which is pretty cool. When you win the big division, you get a belt. If you'd like to be in like a grappling tournament, you could do it. But most people don't care about that stuff. They just want to be able to defend themselves and get home safe. You gotta ask yourself, why do you want to compete? Do you want to do it to show something to someone else or to yourself? Or what are the real reasons? And we can sit down and have a real discussion about that one-on-one because it'll be more pertinent. And at the end of the day, you gotta know why you're doing the things that you do. Some people just do things aimlessly and they don't think, oh, my buddy competed, so I will too. That's fine, but if you have a really good reason to do it, you should do it. If you don't care for it and don't want to, it's absolutely not necessary as well. That's a good question. Keep them coming. Keep them coming. When I look at it, I've been around martial arts since I was 4 years old. I'm turning 31 in April, a week from now. And I've seen so many of the trends come and go, and people get real excited about stuff. To me, it's all the same. It's like, well, can you strike? Can you grapple? Do you know the weapon? Like, you have good footwork. And even though it's like a core art, it's just like, what can you do? Can you move around? Can you hit? Can you hit with power? How's your defense? How's your vision? And how can you take the stuff that you learn and make it real? And that's where like the drills really matter, and the drills in class being dynamic. Just like this, first and foremost, when you're in class in your martial arts, you're usually either paired up with somebody and you're forced to move in relation to somebody else. I have a big problem with these bag classes. Like people just put a bag out, they throw a combination, everybody does a combination. You're not learning as much as if you're relating with somebody with the focus mitts or the boxing glove drill. So I'm a big believer in making the drills real while keeping them safe so you can get good at them.
So Roman is asking if you could demonstrate the inverted hook kick. He struggles with it.
Sure. So that's a cool question. So the inverted hook kick is a kick where your knee turns out the other way and you're hitting the person's groin. So let me just kind of give you the visual. My right foot's forward. His left foot is forward, so we're toe to toe, right? Now, his groin is on this side, so the inverted hook kick, you slide, you turn your foot up, your knee out, and your foot up towards the groin. The inverted hook kick is only thrown when you are in opposite leads or unmatched leads, open stance, right? Not close, open stance. I have one lead, you have the opposite lead. So if my right foot is forward, your left foot would be forward, right? So we're here, we're in fighting position. I take my back foot, I slide it up, my lead knee turns, and I conveniently hit the groin with that kick. Again, you'll never see this kick in a kickboxing class of any kind because you can't kick anybody in the groin in kickboxing. Jeet Kune Do is like the king of foul tactics. Finger jabs, headbutts, kicks to the groin, kicks to the knee, and we've got a gazillion ways to set all that stuff up because we've been doing it for so long and you're just seeing all the setups. And there's more setups than even the stuff that we show because this stuff is infinite. If you could put it in your head and make it mechanically sound, you could do it. Like, you could put the moves together the way you want.
Correct.
Yes, yes, exactly. Yeah, guys, just keep the questions coming. We've got a few more minutes. I'm happy to answer as many as you guys have. I'm having a blast doing this, guys. Like, you know, the family time has been absolutely amazing at home. You know, I get to see my wife, I get to see my kid. But coming here at 7 o'clock kind of just brings you back to normal life, too, where, like, I'm usually teaching in front of a room full of people 2-3 hours a day at a minimum. And as much as I love the live stuff, I love teaching live and feeling people's energy and people asking me the questions in person. And what I love about teaching even more than that is seeing the light bulbs. Person struggling in the class, you show them a couple of tips and tricks and they get better right away. Even better than that, person struggling for a while and then you show them tips and tricks and they have that eureka moment and then they appreciate it a lot more. So seeing the progress on the floor is super fun. I can't see it as much here in the live stream, but it's still a lot of fun doing this because we get to shuck and jive and just like show a bunch of different stuff along the way. So I think that's cool too.
Questions, just comments.
Okay, cool. Yeah, guys, just keep the questions coming. I'll leave it open for another 30, 40 seconds if they come in. Again, just thank you for listening. Thank you for watching. And, you know, again, like I love martial arts. It's part of me. It's part of who I am. It's use this time. I know it's hard for a lot of people. And use martial arts as a way to kind of get over some of the stuff that's obviously happening. Shadow box in your living room. Keep your head clear. You know what I mean? Work some of the moves. Get your head away from this stuff that's in the news. Sit there, you read the news all day, you get depressed. Do something for you. Use this month at a minimum to basically improve yourself, your life, and who you are as a martial artist and a person, and it's going to be a lot better.
So we have from Justin. Are there any other movement arts associated with JKD?
Movement arts. I'm sorry, I don't understand the question. Like,
I think martial arts or anything.
Oh, like is there? Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of martial arts that have influenced Jeet Kune Do, if that's what you're asking. Old school boxing, specifically like Muhammad Ali, Jack Dempsey, Championship Fighting, Bruce Lee looked at a lot of that, and Driscoll from a boxing perspective. Fencing, specifically epee fencing, which allows for interception. Interception just means you hit the guy as he's coming to hit you. That's where Bruce Lee got that idea from. There's some Wing Chun elements in there as well. But it's what works, man. You know, we throw elbows and knees similar to a Muay Thai guy, right? We throw shin kicks, again, very similar to a Muay Thai guy, very different forward. Our hands, if you looked at it from like a layman, a lot of it's very similar to boxing, some of it's different. But it's putting, and our grappling, like we were saying before, is very wrestling-centric, as well as BJJ, but wrestling-centric more than most places. And when you put these things together, I'll make the argument you make a pretty dangerous practitioner. You know, a lot of the instructors here, like if you just chat them up, they did other martial arts. And they'll tell you firsthand the advantages of Jeet Kune Do, the movement, the ability to generate force, the ability to do everything, kick, punch, chop, grapple, and use the weapon, and the fluidity and the fact that it makes sense. You know, a lot of times you'll do an art and 60% of it makes sense and 40% doesn't, but the practitioner doesn't have the skill, the will, and the intellect when it comes to martial arts specifically to be able to dissect it. Jeet Kune Do, everything makes sense. Every move works. It's just a matter of you putting in the time as the practitioner to make those moves yours and be able to pull them off in real time.
So Ramon is asking, slip with a pivot or slip with a corkscrew, is one better than the other, or is it based on a given situation?
The corkscrew is better. So what Ramon is saying is, what's better? Throwing a corkscrew, which is punching as you're curve stepping, or angling and then firing, like pivoting with the slip. So the angle and then the fire, right? In general, the corkscrew, this one is better because you're hitting on the beat. You're hitting as you're moving as opposed to angling and then moving. Now, the reason why you actually do need to know both, sometimes you're in the middle of an exchange, you use that angle to breathe and also to break rhythm. So fatigue is a real variable in real fighting, right? I can't just punch, 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 punch. I'm gonna get exhausted, right? So imagine I'm in a combination, a good reason you would angle and then hit. One, two, three, four. Then I'm like, you know what? Let me breathe. Ha, I create a new angle, breathe, and then hit. The more efficient way though is shh, pop, and I'm hitting on the exit. It's a little bit more labored, you're hitting on the beat. It makes it, it's in general better, but you do need to be able to angle and then hit to break the rhythm and to breathe. Good question too. You guys are giving me great questions. You know what's cool about this? The questions have gotten better throughout time. Like in the beginning, the questions weren't as good as they are now, and what it means to me is you guys are thinking. You guys are actually thinking and making the most of your actual training. We're back guys on Instagram. So what I was saying is what I appreciate a lot is you guys just asking really great questions along the way. Like I think the questions have gotten better and better throughout these live streams. And it shows me that you guys are thinking and you're not just like randomly doing things. You're trying to figure out what's the best thing to do in the context, which is super, super important because the right move is only the right move in the right context, in the right situation. You could throw a picture-perfect move at the wrong time and still get countered. And that's where fight IQ, and that's why what I was telling you is time. It's not just a matter of how good you look doing stuff, like with no one in front of you. It's a matter of being able to pull this off in real time, which takes time. Because you have to pull off the right move, perform it well, and do it at the right time. But it's doable. It's absolutely unequivocally doable. If you train, you will get good. It's literally that simple. So I miss all you guys. I can't wait to see everybody on the training floor when we do open back up. But remember, live streaming classes, 7 to 8 p.m. every weeknight, 12 to 1 on Saturday. You guys are awesome.